This video will assume you have some knowledge of bisection method for solving a single equation. Check out my video if you haven't already. Harvey and Stenger came up with a 2D version of bisection, and then a 3D version was developed by Sierkowski. Sierkowski, Stenger were joined by Eiger, coming up with a more general version of bisection, citing specifically this paper by Kiefert. This video will focus on the 2D version by Harvey and Stenger. I do want to point out two other quick papers though. Kiefer wrote another paper about generalized bisection in general, and then Verhaties wrote an excellent paper about a new version of a generalized bisection. Each of these methods of bisections use different geometries and topologies when solving a system. The simplex approach worked best for dimensions of 5 or fewer. This was in 1984, and the n-dipolyhedron approach worked best for dimensions of 10 or fewer, and this was in 1988. So those numbers should probably be higher now. The 2D approach uses a test to determine if a point is inside a triangle. They then describe an algorithm for finding that solution using bisecting triangles. Note that this video will focus on a simplified version of the algorithm described in the paper. Let's evaluate this system of nonlinear equations. I'm going to color it in a special way. Each of these colors represent a different sign combination of the function. Notice that at each of our solutions, we have all four color combinations. Let's start using these four points that have a different color combination. We'll then connect them to have two triangles. Our solution is in that upper triangle, but we have no idea where that point exactly is. Let's evaluate our function at each of those points. Giving this mapping or transformation of our original points, I'll label them as primes. Let's connect those in the same way, giving two triangles. Our solution is at 0, 0, and we know where this point is. Now we just need a way to figure out which triangle contains our point. Harvey and Stenger came up with what is known as the L test, which looks like this. Note, you actually don't have to use this specific test to figure out if a point is inside a triangle. Here's another version. Going back to our triangle examples, let's just focus on one triangle. Then, if we draw points to that center point, which we'll just call theta, and compute the areas around that, the areas of the whole should be equal to the areas of the sum of its parts. Here's an example with the point outside of our triangle, where our areas don't match up. You can figure out the area by using Heron's formula, labeling each of our lengths as A, B, and C, computing the semi-perimeter, and plugging them into this formula. Of course, this is just one version. You could take the determinant approach using this formula, which comes from this equation with the determinant. Again, the choice is really up to you. One thing to note with the area approach is that you probably won't get exactly equal to in terms of summation. So go with an epsilon approach if you're going to do that. You also don't necessarily need to use area. You could take a convex hull method for finding if a point is inside of a triangle. I actually recommend using Harvey-Stenger's test, but you could come up with some other test to figure out if a point is inside a triangle. Regardless of the test, we know that our point 0, 0 is in the triangle A prime, B prime, C prime, which maps back to A, B, and C. Then we evaluate the midpoint, D, between our longest edge, in this case AC, at this point. Then bisect our triangles in two and restart the process. We'll stop whenever our center of the triangle is less than epsilon in the norm. or our longest side length is less than some epsilon, or reach a maximum number of iterations. I wrote a program to visualize these triangles rather than me having to create them in slides. Here's the first step, the second step, and the third. Notice this idea of bisecting triangles always seems to work. I then iterated a bunch more times. Let's zoom in. Here, I'll stop the iterations, and our final solution will be the center of that triangle. Let's look at the algorithm one more time. We started with 4 points, making sure we had different sign combinations, and then divide them into 2 triangles. Then we tested to see if our point was in our first triangle. In this case, I used the L test. If it was, we put R into T. If it wasn't, we put S into T. I then rotate the triangle so that our first edge is the longest one and call our points A, B, and C. Then figure out the center of our triangle, calling it E, dividing our longest edge into a point D and developing 2 new triangles with bisection. Then check if our final point in the center is small enough in terms of the norm, or our longest distance is small enough. When it isn't, recontinue our bisection approach. When it is, let E be our answer and stop. Recall that we started with these 4 points. We didn't necessarily have to pick these 4. We could have chosen these 4, each of them having that different sign combination. The trouble, though, is that now we don't actually have a solution in either triangle. Our simplified start doesn't guarantee a solution. You could have an alternate starting condition that says, pick a triangle that contains a solution, but that's harder to find than just 4 points with different signs. Going back to Harvey and Stenger's original paper, I mentioned that we covered a simplified version of their algorithm. Here's what their algorithm actually looks like. And you can imagine why we chose the simplified version. Their full algorithm starts by creating a large polygon that's many-sided that it would enclose our solution by then dividing it into triangles and measuring the angles of the triangles to figure out the topology, afterwards combining them to create parallelograms, and then doing backtracking steps if you don't end up finding a solution, and many other steps. I'll link to the paper in the description if you are curious. Now you might be wondering, what about a hybrid version similar to Brent Decker, in which you combined bisection with seeking method? Well, you could imagine a generalized version of seeking method combined with generalized bisection, which identified areas in triangles, and if the secant step ever was outside of a triangle, you'd force a bisection. You could do something similar with Newton bisection hybrid, combining generalized units method with generalized bisection. To recap, this lesson covered a method of bisecting triangles to solve systems of nonlinear equations, with the key element being that we could figure out if a point was inside of a triangle, like 0. Note that our area is halved each iteration, so essentially converging linearly. Keep in mind that our simplified version of the algorithm needs to be careful where you choose your starting points. There are also different ways to hybrid bisection with other methods. Harvey and Stenger also proved in their paper sufficient conditions for convergence, which I am not going to go over. The code that I wrote will be hosted on GitHub. As always, thank you for watching. This lesson was probably one of the hardest to put together, even though the concept of bisecting triangles sounds like a simple idea on paper. If you're curious, I already have a lesson on generalized false position method that I'll have a card to here in the end screen. Again, thank you for watching.